Hey, Evan, it is so wonderful to chat with you again. Today is food day, and we're having some really challenging and interesting discussions here at COP. You and I know, everybody knows, we're in the middle of probably one of the worst food crises we've seen. And in general, our food system, while producing more than enough food, is still leaving a billion people, you know, hungry or, you know, without access to sufficient food. So we do have a problem, but there's some interesting debates that are starting to emerge. We have a crisis. Can we actually do a transformation at the same time, or do we focus on the crisis? Should every country start to produce its own food, given all the disruptions we've seen in the supply chain? I want to start off this conversation by asking you, where is your head on this now that you've seen this debate here as well?
This is one of the big conversations of the generation. I mean, when the history books of the 21st century are written, there will be a significant chapter on the food system transformation. Right now, we're focused on three bad C's: conflict, climate change, and COVID. And both of those have really upended the fundamental assumptions of our industrial food system. So what do we do about it? Well, I think we need to invest in technology, first of all, in order to shrink agriculture's environmental footprint. And that is an absolute necessary imperative. At the same time, the reason there's about a billion people on the planet unable to access a safe, nutritious diet hasn't to do with production. It has to do with poverty, it has to do with marginalization, it has to do with the legacy of colonialism and racism. It's these structural, social, and economic issues which are disenfranchising, you know, almost a billion people probably. It's hard to actually count exactly, but a significant percentage of the world's population. And really addressing that question of access is a matter of social policy and economic policy much more than it is about agriculture. For me, the agricultural question is saving the planet, not undermining the ecosystems we all depend on for life, and the question of access is a social issue.
Interesting. So let's talk about the technology part, yeah. Right? The agriculture part of it. You've written a book with a very exciting title. It's called Dinner on Mars. Definitely makes one want to pick it up and read it, and it's a great book. Tell us a little bit about the technologies that you see coming in and what role technology you think will play.
So the book comes out of COVID, and my good friend Lenore Newman and I started texting each other in March of 2020 about, well, we can't travel, where can we go in our imaginations to study a food system? So we thought, well, let's design the food system for a Martian community, because we could do that while locked in our bedrooms in March of 2020. And actually, as we were researching those technologies, we realized these are the technologies we need here on Earth. And they're hyper, hyper efficient. They use every input, every, you know, photon of solar energy is precious, every gram of organic matter, every bit of labor is precious, because you can't assume that you've got this, you know, lush biosphere and a cheap labor force to exploit in order to produce food. So the technologies to produce a food on Mars are hyper efficient. They're also closed loop technologies. You don't just produce something in one part and sort of throw it away in another part. On Mars, you know, there can be no such thing as waste. So it's a circular economy that brings waste products from one part of the system as inputs into the other part of the system. So efficiency, closed loop, and then very little in the way of animal-based proteins. So we have to sort of fix the animal-based protein problem. And I'm not a vegetarian. I want to eat steak and ice cream for the rest of my life. And I realize that we all as a global society have to eat less steak and ice cream, and we need to therefore find much lower environmental footprint alternatives, not because we all have to become vegan, but because we all collectively have to find lower cost alternatives in terms of the environment.
Yeah. It's a brilliant and fascinating insight of how if you start from scratch, you can actually design something, right? Now we gotta retrofit it in. Last quick question. You and I are all having conversations with a lot of policymakers around here, and many of the policymakers are talking to each other. We know the need for an enabling policy environment. Very quickly, what are your big thoughts on what's needed to accelerate the transformation in agriculture?
Yeah, so we can't be technologically utopian. I mean, technologies are never a panacea, and they need that enabling policy environment. So we need an environment that rewards farmers for protecting the environment. I mean, financially rewards them. So that's things like payment for ecosystem services is sometimes what it's called. Carbon price mechanisms is another mechanism. We need policies that protect labor and animal welfare much more strongly than we currently have, I would argue. And we need policies that really, really put a priority on investing in those technologies that will reduce the environmental footprint of agriculture. And those are the sort of technology bundles that I think are necessary.
Fantastic. It is always such a pleasure to chat with you. Thank you so much for your time.
My pleasure. Thank you.